Welcome to Deep Lizard. My name's Mandy, and in this episode, we'll discuss how to process data for deep learning. Later, we'll use this data to train our very first artificial neural network. To train any neural network, we first need a data set of samples, as well as the corresponding labels for these samples. Now, when we say the word samples, we're really just referring to a data set where each individual data point in the set is referred to as a sample. For example, if we were to train a model to do sentiment analysis on headlines from media sources, then the labels for each corresponding headline sample would be positive or negative. And as another example, if we were to train a neural network to identify whether images were images of cats or images of dogs, then for each corresponding image sample, the label would be cat or dog. Note that in deep learning, sometimes you might hear the word samples also referred to as inputs or input data. And you might hear labels referred to as targets or target data. After acquiring a data set, we need to understand what format the data needs to be in for the particular end goal that we have in mind. So for us, our goal is to train a neural network, and therefore we need to make sure that the data is in a format that our neural network can accept. The first deep learning model that we'll be building in an upcoming episode is called a sequential model, and that model is from the Keras API integrated within TensorFlow. And we'll discuss all the details about the sequential model in that later episode when we build it. But for now, we just need to understand what format the data should be in that we'll be passing to that sequential model. During the training process, a sequential model receives the data whenever we call the fit function on the model. So then we need to check the TensorFlow documentation for fit to understand the data format that the fit function accepts. All right, so here is the documentation for the fit function. And the first two parameters that fit expects are x and y, where x is the input data or the samples, and y is the target data or the labels for those samples. So if we scroll down to look at the format for x, our input data, it can be a NumPy array, a TensorFlow tensor, a dict mapping, a tf.data dataset, or a generator. And if you don't know about all of these different data types, it's okay. We will be working with a NumPy array, which is the simplest type of data format that we can get this first example of data that we'll be going through together. We'll put it into a simple NumPy array. So that is fine. And now for Y, the target data, it needs to be formatted in a similar fashion as X. So for example, if our input data is stored in a NumPy array, then the labels for that input data cannot be stored in a TF tensor, for example. They also need to be stored in a NumPy array. So now that we understand how we'll be formatting the data, let's get to doing that right now. Now, data processing for deep learning can vary greatly depending on the type of data that we're working with, as well as the type of task that we'll be using the network for. Just to give a few examples, data could be coming from a sensor, from a self-driving car in real time. It could be coming from a SQL database of medical information. It could be coming from images that you have downloaded from a website. So the possibilities are pretty endless, but we'll start out with a very simple numerical data set. which we'll actually be generating ourselves just for this example. And for the task, it will be a simple classification task that we'll be using our neural network for. All right, so jumping into the code, the first thing we need to do is import the required libraries that we'll be working with, which are just the random library from Python and NumPy and scikit-learn. Next, we need to create two empty lists, one to hold our training labels and one to hold our training samples. Now, I said that we would be generating our data. So this is complete dummy data. It's not real, but we are just making up this very simple data set to use for our first example to get introduced to numerical data processing. So as motivation for this data set, here is a little made up background story for it. So let's suppose that an experimental drug was tested on individuals ranging from 13 to 100 years old in a clinical trial. And this trial had 2,100 participants, half of which were under the age of 65, and the other half were 65 years of age or older. And 95% of the people who were 65 or older experienced some type of side effect from the drug, and 95% of participants who were under the age of 65 did not experience any side effects. All right, so that is kind of the made-up background story for our data set. Now we're going to create this data set and then go forward and process it. All right, now so to create this data set, we're first going to run this for loop, which is going to generate the 5% of younger individuals who did experience side effects. So this code is pretty straightforward. We're just choosing random numbers ranging from 13 to 64, representing the ages of individuals who are under 65 years old. And then we are going to add those individuals that we're creating based on age to our trained samples. And then we're going to append a 1 to our train labels list. And 1 is meaning that the individual did experience a side effect. So 1 means side effect experienced, 0 means no side effect experienced. And then after that, we're going to do the same thing, but generate the 5% of older individuals who did not experience side effects. So same code, this time we are just generating random numbers between 65 and 100. And then the labels for this small group are going to all be 0, given that they did not experience a side effect. And then scrolling down a bit, again, same thing here. This new for loop is going to be generating most of our data. It's going to be generating the 95% of younger individuals who did not experience side effects, and the 95% of older individuals who did experience side effects. All right, so we'll just run this cell. And now just to show what our train samples look like, if we print them out, then we can just see this list of random ages ranging anywhere from 13 to 100 years old. And if we want to see what the corresponding labels look like, again, this is just a list with the labels of 0 or 1, depending, or which represent individuals who experienced side effects or who did not experience side effects. Now, the next step, we need to convert both of these lists, our train samples and our train labels, into NumPy arrays based on what we saw from the fit function documentation earlier. Then we just need to shuffle our labels and samples to get rid of any order that was imposed on the data set during the creation process. So let's run this cell. And lastly, we are going to scale down the data. So right now, the training samples are ranging from a scale of 13 to 100. So we're going to scale those numbers down to be on a range from 0 to 1 using scikit-learn's min-max scaler. So we first specify the range that we want, which is 0 to 1, and then we use the fit transform function, which will actually transform our training samples from the ages of, or from the underlying data being on a scale from 13 to 100, to instead be on a scale from 0 to 1. And this reshape function that we're calling on the end of trained samples, that's just a formality because the fit transform function doesn't accept 1D data by default, so we just have to reshape accordingly here. Now that we have rescaled our data, we can print out our scaled trained samples, which is what we've called our data set after the transformation. And we can see now, instead of being on a range from 13 to 100, we have these numbers here ranging from 0 to 1. And if you need more information for why the scaling process would be useful, then check out the corresponding episode linked in the blog from the Deep Learning Fundamentals course, which will explain why these normalization and standardization processes might be useful for training your neural network. All right, so now we have created and processed our data set, which we'll later use to train our first artificial neural network. Note that with the simplicity of this data set, along with the conclusions that we can draw from it, a neural network may be a bit of overkill given just how simple it is. However, note that we're going through this process of creating and using a very simple data set just for our very first beginning project. And later, like I mentioned earlier, we'll be working with more complex and more practical or realistic data sets in the future. Now, because we are filming this from Vietnam right now, we are experiencing all sorts of construction noises and motorbikes racing by our apartment. And so those things are beyond our control. So if you heard those in the episode, that's what's going on. And if you're interested in hearing more about why we are in Vietnam and what we do outside of teaching deep learning, then head over to Deep Lizard Vlog on YouTube to see our videos where we show, where we document our travels and show other things from our everyday lives. Also, be sure to check out the corresponding blog for this episode on deeplizard.com and check out the Deep Lizard Hive Mind, where you can get download access to the code that we use in this course, along with other interesting rewards. I'll see you next time.